Well, here I am at the Capitol. This is a little different kind of show. I'm at the Capitol of Lego Systems International in Enfield, Connecticut. And what we're going to see here today is preparation for their huge 7,000 square foot display at the Mall of America in Bloomington, Minnesota. And we're going to see huge displays. We're going to meet the designers who create them. We're going to watch Legos being born in the building behind me, follow the process of how they're created and put together. And we're just going to see some phenomenal, beautiful, creative things made out of Lego bricks. So this right here is the U.S. Capitol building, made entirely of Lego bricks. There's one just like it in Epcot Center. So follow me and take a tour of Lego Systems. Welcome inside the Lego building. I'm with Francie Berger, who is, your official title is?
Senior Model Designer and Model Production Supervisor.
And I first read about Francie in the New Yorker, and I've since actually read about her in other places, and she is responsible for some of the phenomenal creations made by Lego. If anybody's been to Epcot Center, if you've been to FAO Schwartz, you get a small glimpse of what they're capable of and what they're preparing for now. What's the big project?
This is Mall of America. We're winding down now. We've been working on it for about 2 years, and it's the biggest project we've ever done. It'll be the first ever Lego store in the United States and the first permanent display area that we'll have here in this country.
So these are creations just built specifically and designed specifically for this giant display.
Yeah, we were given 5,000 square feet to fill up, so what we did was went through, picked a number of different theme areas that we thought would appeal to everybody, and that's what we're building models for now.
Okay, and how do you start out? Do you have a brainstorming sessions, and so to speak?
Or that's exactly right. About eight of us sit down, brainstorm out the ideas, things that we think have a wide range of appeal, come up with about 20 or 30 ideas that are pretty good, and work our way down the list and scale it down to the three or four that seem workable. So that's what we've ended up with.
And the design process itself, is it, you know, architectural in nature? I mean, is there actual blueprints for these structures? They look so playful, and they're all so, you know, a lot of them are just, they're all fun, but they don't look like, you know, kids don't draw what they're going to do first. They just do it. How do you work?
Yes, ours are a little more complex just because they're bigger. What we do is start with a concept sketch, just like a kid might. And then we've got some specially scaled graph paper. We've got two different types. We've got bricks seen from the side and bricks seen as a plan view, so looking down at them. What we do is sketch up our ideas on the graph paper. It kind of helps us to make round shapes with square bricks, which is a lot of what we're doing most of the time. And then we'll actually build using the graph paper as a guide. So it's a little bit more planned out than your average child would do.
I'm with Keith.
Keith Fettridge. I'm a model designer here at Lego Systems.
Okay. How did you get started here? What was your interest?
I started about 7 years ago. I started as a model builder, which are the people out there that glue the bricks together. And over the past 7 years, worked my way up to being a model designer. And now I work full-time designing models.
And what kind of things have you worked on for the Mall of America exhibit?
Oh, I've done some acrobat figures, some lions and tigers for the ring, circus ring there. I've also done some work on a space shuttle with the space station as well, so that'll be one little scene. Some kind of futuristic looking space figures as well.
Now, we were looking at those heads on the shelves before. They are these are just kind of projects for figures that are developed for the displays, or are they just little fun, these little experiments in sculpture?
These are our heads for the figures that are going to the Mall of America. They're just kind of cartoony, realistic looking people, no one really in general, just faces that we made.
Okay, this is we're looking at graph paper, which this is the basis of designs.
Yeah, when we design a model, we use the graph paper for all the models we do. It really helps in creating a rounded or round-looking model with the use of the square bricks.
What are these shapes? Is this like a cross section or a top view?
What we have are two different types of brick paper. This one here is the plan view. It shows the brick from the top. And this one here is the elevation, which shows the brick from the side. And working between the two different brick papers and a lot of drawing, you come up with a three-dimensional model.
Now, I've noticed with even my own son, there's some very, you know, delicate construction that goes on. And, you know, if you get an arm sticking out too far, you know, is there tricks for kids that little tips you can give them for support or a way to start a structure?
The key to keeping everything together and not falling apart is interlocking. It's just like a brick building. If all the bricks were just stacked one on top of each other, it'd be individual walls that could fall apart. And we're doing the same thing with the toys here.
So just constant overlaps and interlocks. And who is this particular one that we were looking at?
This right here, this is the top view of this lady's figure right here. And this is the front view looking at the model this way.
Mm-hmm. That's phenomenal.
And this is one of the acrobats for Mall of America.
Will that be in motion? Will it be?
No, she's going to be climbing a ladder, kind of telling people this is everything. She's presenting the tightrope walkers.
All right. I'm with Mark, and your official job here is
display designer. And what we do in display design is design all the non-brick elements to the Mall of America or any other projects that we might be working on. That means we lay out the models in the Mall of America area and design environments and protection for the models. So a lot of times it's a kind of a mixture of both, where, you know, we're trying to put in a protective enclosure around the model that also creates an environment. Right now we are working on some of the upper space platforms, and that's what we have on the screen there. And that is platform number 3, and it's basically a kind of a man-made crater with a truss system. And what we're looking at would be, you know, how to use the space to enhance the models, really. Right now, Felix is working on a blown-up Lego brick that would be used in a construction platform.
We've got these little construction worker figures. These are actually going to be brick models. These are models that we've designed. And what Mark and Felix are doing are designing large display elements to kind of enhance the podium, kind of. It'll look like the actual construction figures are working on these large plastic elements that these guys are designing in here. So it's a real group effort.
All right, what you're working on?
This is the space shuttle. It's been doubled up to twice the size of the model that we have already built. We'll have open doors that will come here and a removable satellite that will be in a position lifted out when it's hung.
That's great. How long a project is this? This is your own personal project?
Right. About 5 weeks.
Great. How many blocks will it take?
Don't know.
No yet.
Don't know.
Right. All right, what are we looking at here, Francie?
Well, this is a spaceship that we're going to have hanging in the mall. One of the interesting challenges of this project was that we had a 90-foot ceiling height to deal with. So it's really a lot of volume if you think about it. So not only were we building designs just to put on the floor, but we really had to fill that space up. So you're going to see a lot of large hanging models. We've got a spaceship here. We've got an 8-foot-long blimp that's going to go up there. We've got a 6-foot-in-diameter globe of the world. We've got a moon. And there's going to be the space shuttle that we just looked at, and there will also be a replica of the space station.
Excuse me, Keith.
Yes.
What's going on at this station here?
Well, Stephen is working on a model where he's coming up with the original design, coming up with the concept, and we're just looking at size and the overall view of this thing and how it will look.
And this is going to be, this is a Maharaja of some sort?
Yeah, it's a Sultan, actually, on a flying carpet, yeah.
And this is going to appear at the mall?
No, actually, it's not going to, but maybe someday it will. It's going to be one of our traveling model displays. It's going to go around the country to different stores.
And how big will he be in scale?
It's about a six-foot figure right there, so he's just a little less than 6 feet tall.
And that'll be from completion to when is that ready to start production?
We have about 6 or 7 weeks design time, say, from today, and then they will fit in the actual production sometime in about Toy Fair time or, you know, November, December time, probably.
Did you play with Legos as a kid?
Sure did.
And one of the design tricks that we use in here is we might design something at half the scale that it'll actually be built. Look to my left, we've got the original model of the globe. And it took us a lot less time than building it in the actual size that we wanted it to. So when the model builders build some of these things, what they're actually doing is doubling everything they see. If they see that something is one brick tall, it'll become two bricks tall in their model. That's how we'll get something this size.
And I like you can get a You Are Here Lego brick right there in Connecticut.
That's us.
Oh. Okay, here we are in my personal playroom with all my Legos. How many different configurations of bricks are there?
There's over 1,300 different types of elements, and best part about this job is that we've got every single one of them in here, in quantity. It's every kid's fantasy.
Now, if you were trapped on a desert island, you had a choice of one Lego kit, one retail available Lego kit to play with for the next 6 months. Any particular favorites?
That's a tough question. I've always been partial to the castle sets, and now that the pirates are in, they're a lot of fun too. But I think I'd probably have to go with the biggest castle set.
But did they ever do any kind of research where they videotape kids with Lego bricks? And
we personally don't, but one of the things that we as designers like to do is try to keep up on what's hip with the kids, you know, try and incorporate that kind of thing into our models, skateboards, surfboards, Walkmans, that type of thing.
You are Paul.
Paul Sean.
How do you do? And what's your job here?
I'm a model designer also, yeah.
And which one are you working on? What are we seeing here on the
right now
blueprint?
Right now, it's going to be a store model that is going to be about 6 feet tall when it's completed, and it's a dragon with a castle.
Now, you make this paper, that's your preliminary?
I made that, yeah, just to give a three-dimensional look to it. So
and the next stage is the blueprint and
yeah,
the block by block.
And then draw it up. Just sort of sketch like that. And then what I do is I just trace the brick paper on it and trace out all the little steps that'll be necessary. And right now I'm getting this foot worked on, which is it's over here. So I just started really.
Okay, how far away until this guy is ready?
Oh, probably 3 or 4 more weeks at least.
Yeah. All right, this is like found treasure here, you know, for a kid. So I stuff my pockets with these, make myself a hero at home. We're going to look around at some more things, but what kind of things can we expect to see when we go outside for the Mall of America display?
Well, two of our really big themes are we've got a dinosaur area, so we're going to see some big dinosaurs probably. And one of our biggest themes in there is a three-ring circus complete with flying trapeze artists and such, so you're going to see a lot of circus characters out there too.
Do you dream in Legos?
Yeah, I don't like to admit that, but yeah, absolutely.
Have you conceived the projects in dreams? I mean, have you woken up and thought of great ideas?
Yeah, it's pretty cliche, but you do wake up at 3 o'clock in the morning and have to write your great ideas down because that's when the best ideas happen.
We're going to take a short break for about a minute, and then we'll be right back with Francie and Keith and the rest of the crew at the Lego Systems and look at some more amazing parts of the Mall of America display. We'll be right back.
Hi, I'm Robin Leach of Lifestyles of the Rich and Famous, and you're watching Miggs B on television. Me and Miggs B? Stay tuned, you'll find out why I always drink champagne when I cook.
Welcome back. We're here at Lego Systems in Enfield, and you are looking at the incredible array of machinery that molds, stamps, sorts, and wraps millions and millions of Lego bricks every year. I'm with Dave Lafreni, Public Relations Manager of Lego Systems, and we are on our way into the birthing room, the place where it all begins.
Right in here.
I'm standing over a vat of granules. This is the raw material?
Yeah, this is the ABS plastic. This is the beginning of a Lego brick. We refer to it as how a brick is born, and from here it is fed into the molding area, and that's how the injection molding machines produce a Lego brick.
And they all come in the prescribed colors?
In the Lego, in the Lego colors, the primary colors, right.
And then they're just melted down and
injection molding machines, and out comes a Lego brick.
Amazing. Meehan here in the Lego Systems workshop, and your function here is to do what?
I'm the display department coordinator. My main function is to make sure that all the materials that we need to have to build all the displays are here on the correct times. I put together all the schedules for any of the displays that we're going to build. I coordinate all the time for the guys that work here in the shop to build the displays and put the animation in the models. Anything that has to be protected in the models, any crating that needs to be done, any enclosures that the models need to go into, all comes out of this department. So anything that is non-brick related, and when I say bricks, the little Lego bricks, any of the other things that go into the displays, I take care of here in this department.
This Mall of America, is this the biggest project that's come along here in a while?
So far it is. The Mall of America project is about 7,000 square feet of a retail slash display store. It's the biggest project that we've worked on. It's the most permanent project that we've ever worked on. We've got a set of blueprints here. It's not a complete set, but it does go through and show some of the different things that we will be building here in the display department. This is an artist's rendering of one area, and I'm sure that you've already seen the large dinosaurs. It will have around the dinosaurs an enclosure to help protect the dinosaurs, but also to add an environment to them. There's some movements in these dinosaurs, there's some large palm trees, and there's a fiberglass rock structure that goes around them to really add a nice environment.
This appears to be a Legosaurus Rex.
That's correct.
And does this originate in your workshop?
Well, what happened was once we sat down to figure the whole project out, we realized that with four designers and 10 model builders, we just couldn't quite do everything we wanted to do. So we got a little help from the design department in Denmark. One of the things you might be wondering is why he's got wooden sticks sticking out of his belly there. What we're doing is demonstrating that some of the larger models actually do have to come apart in two or three pieces just to make them easier to move. And one of the other interesting things about the dinosaurs in particular is that a lot of them are going to be animated, and we need to be able to have access to the insides of the models so that we can put the motors in and whatever air cylinders and things that we're going to need to actually move the models. So his arms will be moving. I believe his jaw will be going up and down, so he's pretty fierce looking.
Yeah, great. Yeah,
we'll paint your hands slowly. Real slow. It doesn't get more behind the scenes than this, does it, Miggs?
Apparently some sort of dinosaur on skates with a boombox.
Yeah, I think they patterned him after somebody from out in Venice Beach, actually.
And even the little cables are made out of
Are they? Yeah,
they're. Yes, everything in there is a Lego element. Like I said, you should be able to recreate any of this at home, so we don't cheat at all. We've got some real strict rules about that.
All right, Francie, what's so special about this guy?
Well, once this little guy is plugged in, he's going to be clawing the air with his paws just like a real lion would do. And one of the interesting things about the mechanizations that we do in here is that we'll only put a movement into a model that a child could either do with a Lego motor or it could do manually. So we might stick a little airplane on a stick and have it flying in circles, but only because a child could actually pick that airplane up and run around the room with it. We wouldn't do something that was really impossible for someone to recreate at home. So the theory behind any of this is that if you do have enough bricks, you can build anything that we build.
Doesn't talk. It's all right. Handsome guy.
This next page here shows a full layout of the floor plan of the mall. And like I said, it is 7,000 square feet. There are raised platforms above the floor level at a 10-foot level here, another three raised platforms that are 20 feet high, and another three that are 30 feet high. You've already seen probably out in my storeroom out there the circus rings that have been produced by the display department. All of these things that go into here, there's displays around each area here. There's displays on each one of these levels. There's a display here that's already been built that has been used previously in our New York City showroom. That we took that out of there, we rolled it over, and we're going to use it in the Mall of America project also. This is the print that we start working with, and it's a concept drawing. From that, we can take some material takeoffs and get a good figure of what we're going to use for material, how much plexiglass might go into it, how we're going to build the panels down the bottom, what kind of aluminum extrusion we're going to use, how we're going to integrate all these materials together.
Is this the largest? It's the largest thing we've seen so far, but is this the largest single exhibit, this carousel that's going out there?
This is actually one of the circus rings in the three-ring circus. We do have one dinosaur that stands about 14 feet tall, so he's the largest single model. This is one of the larger package exhibits here. We've got three rings in the circus, and they were all patterned after actual circus acts. We did a lot of research into this. And you know that when you go out to the circus, you always see the tigers jumping through the hoops and the lion tamer, so here they are. There's going to be a lot of movement in this ring. All the animals will have some kind of motion to them. See that the hoop is on fire, and those flames will actually be flickering as though they really were in flames. And the lion tamer will have a whip, and he'll be cracking the whip.
As you can see here, we're putting the models together and designing them and fabricating them and getting them ready to go out to Bloomington. So it's an exciting project, and it's one that I think the American public and visitors from all parts of the world, when they come to the mall, are going to thoroughly enjoy.
This is Lego Systems' first retail outlet in the country?
Yeah, adventure of this type. But we've had traveling shows, model shows, fun shows, and world shows that have gone to different malls and retail stores. So people have had the opportunity to experience our product and see what you can do with it. But this is the first time anywhere in this country that there'll be a permanent exhibition space, and with that also a Lego store, so when children and families go through there, they can purchase memorabilia and certain Lego toys.
Yeah, well, I know in Epcot you have a little sort of like a store there, and
in conjunction with the U.S. Capitol that we had down there recently, exactly. But that was a little bit different than this. This is, you're talking about close to 7,000 square feet of nothing but models that we're looking at right now.
So that's almost like a theme park, but there are plans for an actual theme park, are there?
Exactly. Right now we're looking at seven sites around the world, four in Western Europe and three in the United States, and those sites are the San Diego area, the Boston area, and the Washington, D.C. area. And by the end of this year or the beginning of next, we'll choose a site for the first Lego World theme park.
I want to thank Dave LaFrenny for welcoming us into the magical world of Lego Systems. And thank you to Francie Berger and Keith Fetridge for giving us a very special look at all the creative people and projects that make up this terrific company. Since 1949, over 110 billion Lego bricks have been molded, and the imagination of millions and millions of children have been enriched. If you're ever in Bloomington, Minnesota, go to the Mall of America and see a fantastic store.